where after describing subspaces that have an infinite number of vectors in them with a finite number of vectors, and we would like to have as few vectors as possible so that the span of those vectors is that entire subspace. What that means is that we don't want to include vectors that we don't have to. And what that brings up is the notion of linear independence. So what's that? Okay, well, let's go through a couple of examples. Here we have the span of the vectors 1, 0, 0, 1, and we have the span of the vectors 1, 0, 0, 1, 1, 1. Is it the case that these two vectors can generate the same set of vectors as these three vectors? The answer is yes. And why is that? Well, if you set S to be the span of this, and T to be the span of this, then S is a subset of T. Why? Because if you start with a vector x in the span here, then you know there's an alpha 0, alpha 1, such that x can be written as that. That's what it means to be in the span of it. But then you can certainly write it as this right here, where you pick 0 to multiply 1, 1, 0. And therefore, we can find coefficients such that a linear combination of these three vectors equals x, and therefore we know that x is in the span of these three vectors. Now, it's also the case that if you let S be this right here and T this set right here, then T is a subset of S. Why? Anytime you want to show that something is a subset of another set, what you do is you pick an arbitrary vector in that set, and you show that that vector is then also in the other set. Well, X being in the span of this means that there's some linear combination of those vectors that equals X. But we can take this vector and write it as a linear combination of 1, 0, 0, 1. As a matter of fact, just write it as 1, 0, 0, 1. Now you have X described in terms of those two vectors, and you can actually then use commutivity of vector addition to show that it's alpha 0 plus alpha 2 times 1, 0, and alpha 1 plus alpha 2 times 0, 1. So X is also in S. So what's really going on here? What's really going on here is that we did not need this vector, because that vector itself can be written as a combination of these two vectors. This vector here is a linear combination of those two vectors. Anytime you have a vector in the set that is a linear combination of other vectors, you don't need that vector. Okay. So having fewer vectors is better than having more. So the question now is, how do we come up with a notion of the fewest? How do we know that we have a set of vectors where we can't do without any of those vectors? Okay, and this is where this definition comes in. If you have n vectors, v0 through vn minus 1, then they're said to be linearly independent if taking a linear combination of those vectors can only result in the zero vector when you pick the coefficients with which you are constructing your linear combination to all be equal to zero. Now, if the set of vectors is not linearly independent, then it's said to be linearly dependent. So a set of vectors being linearly independent is good. A set of vectors being linearly dependent is generally not so good. So, go and do this homework and come back. So what does this homework really say? It says here that if these vectors are linearly dependent, then at least one of those vectors can be written as a linear combination of the others. And what we saw was that if one of the vectors can be written as a linear combination of the others, then we can throw that vector out of the set of vectors with which we create the span, because we don't get any extra vectors in the set that the span describes by having that particular vector in the spanning set. So this is true. Why is it true? Well, if it's linearly dependent, then we know that there's a set of coefficients such that taking this linear combination gives you zero. And we know that at least one of those is not equal to zero, because otherwise it's the case that you can only get zero from taking zero coefficients here. And what that would mean is that it is not linearly dependent, namely it's linearly independent. You know that this here is true, and you know that for some chi j, it's not equal to zero. So what can we do? We can take all of the terms that are not the term indexed with j and move those to the other side. What that means is that we get all of this, and notice if you look very carefully, the jth term is missing here. That jth term we leave on the left. Now we know that that chi j is not zero. Therefore we can divide through. And therefore we see that the jth vector can be written as a linear combination of all of the other vectors, where the coefficients are given by these ratios. So, this set of vectors is linearly dependent. Why? Because this vector can be written as a linear combination of these two vectors. Or more generally, we can take a linear combination of those vectors and generate the zero vector. Sometimes we like to talk about a set of vectors. Sometimes we like to take those vectors and make them into the columns of a matrix. So what do we have here? The theorem here says that the vectors a0 through an minus 1 are linearly independent if and only if you take those vectors and make them into a matrix, that matrix only has the zero vector in its null space. How can you prove that? Well, start by assuming that these vectors are linearly independent. You need to show that then the null space of this matrix is zero. Assume x is in the null space of A. You know then that A times x is equal to zero, but then you know that zero is equal to A times x, which can be written as such, which is then the linear combination of all of these vectors. But you know that this is only equal to zero if these coefficients are equal to zero, and therefore we conclude that x must be the zero vector. So anytime the vector maps to zero, it must be the zero vector. Therefore, the null space of A can only contain the zero vector. Okay, if we go the other direction, what are we going to do? Instead of proving that if the null space of A only has the zero vector in it, then the vectors a0 through an and minus 1 are linearly independent, what we're going to do is we're going to say, if these vectors are not linearly independent, then the null space of A has to contain more than just a zero vector. That's known as the contrapositive. So, assume that these vectors are not linearly independent, in other words, that they are linearly dependent, then we know that there is some set of coefficients, some of which are not equal to zero, at least one of which is not equal to zero, such that you get a linear combination that adds up to zero. And if we then let x be the column vector, then we know that a times x is equal to zero, which means that x is then in that null space, and therefore we know that there is a non-zero vector in the null space. Okay, so here was the last example. We could view this as a matrix, and notice that we can find a non-zero vector that maps to zero when multiplied by that matrix. Therefore, we know that the columns of this matrix are linearly dependent. Now, some examples. The columns of the identity matrix form linearly independent set of vectors. Okay, well, the proof is simply that it's pretty easy to see that the null space of the identity is just the zero vector. The columns of a lower triangular matrix are linearly independent. Why is that? Well, we saw that Lx equal to zero only has the zero vector as its solution if the diagonal elements of L are non-zero. Therefore, only the zero vector is in the null space, therefore the columns of a lower triangular matrix must be linearly independent. And this is just a generalization of that. Okay, now if you have a lower triangular matrix like this, and then you tack another row to it, that turns out to be linearly independent as well. Why is that? Well, let's call this L0 and let's call this L1 transpose. What if we had an x such that L times x is equal to 0? Well, then L0 L1 transpose times x has to be equal to 0. But that means that L0 x is equal to 0. But this now is a lower triangular matrix with non-zeros on the diagonal. And we know that that then means that x must be the 0 vector. Okay, so here's a theorem. If you have n vectors that are all in Rm, and you have more vectors than the length of the vector, then these vectors must be linearly dependent. Okay, and the proof of that is to think of this as a matrix. The matrix turns out to be m by n. But what this here means is that you have more columns than you have rows. And what does that mean? That means that you have more variables for which to solve than you have equations. And that inherently means that you have vectors in a null space. And that inherently then means that the columns of this matrix must be linearly dependent. And that then inherently means that these vectors must be linearly dependent. If we have a square matrix, then if A is non-singular, we had all of these conditions that were equivalent, and we can now add some to it. Okay, the column space of A must be all of Rn. A must have linearly independent columns, and the null space of A can only have the zero vector in it.